Okay, so welcome everybody. I am Tatiana Bazzichelli, running the Disruption Network Club, together also with two wonderful women, Kim Voss and Daniela Silvestrin. We are a program funded by Upstadt Kulturfond Berlin, and we have as main co-operator the Kunstraum Kreuzberg Bethanien, Stefan Bauer. And for this specific event, we have a collaboration with the Nome Gallery and also with the Spectrum, that is an independent space that just opened in Berlin last June. So I also wanted to remind you that over there, there is a small table where you can buy and see the catalogs of the Nome Gallery. And also, if you want, you can get some posters of the show. And so I would reconnect briefly to that because on the 10th of September, we open at the Nome Gallery the solo exhibition of Jacob Applebaum, an exhibition that is entitled Samizdata, Evidence of Conspiracy. And this is also the title of our conference. And yesterday, we had a panel with Jacob Applebaum, Teresa Zucker, and Laura Poitras. Today, we go on with our plan, and I also would like specifically to thank the Office of Quebec in Berlin, because they supported the coming of Sophie Toupin. And so I want to actually welcome the participants, Sophie Toupin, Jørgen Johansen, and Jaromil, and the moderator, Valie Djordjevic. And I briefly just introduce a bit what we are going to speak today, because I think also there is an interesting connection with yesterday. The title of this specific panel is Samizdata Strategies for Resistance. So we want to reflect on how it's possible today to speak about resistance 2 years after the Snowden disclosure, and also in which way we can open a certain reflection and certain practices to a broader public that also involves other form of expertise, so hackers, whistleblowers, activists, artists. I think the interesting aspect of today would be also to bring really concrete proposals and projects that could be reflected upon, and also try to imagine new form of post-digital resistance in search of a positive alternative, because actually we also started to reflect on this panel with Jaromil, and saying that he will say more in this presentation, but the idea was also to try to reflect on how it's possible not to just get trapped in the fear of surveillance and also get hidden, but trying also to be active and an active agent to find alternative and form of resistance that could empower everybody. So now I just want to tell you a specific thing that since we think we should find a different strategy, but at the same time it's also important still to keep going in awareness of technology. So our partnership with Spectrum today is also related to a crypto party that will happen at 6 in Burkenstrasse 12. So I also invite you after our event to go there. If you have your computer, is great, but if you don't, you can also just bring your mobile phone and also learn how to use safely your equipment. And I conclude to introduce Valie Djordjevic, then she will introduce the other participants. She works in Berlin and she's the editor of iRight Info, that is a website about copyright in the digital age. And actually, I know Valie since really long time, I would say, because she has been deeply involved with the net culture, net art, and also feminist, digital, not digital movements in Berlin and internationally. So she's also a co-founder of the Faces mailing list, Women in Media, that's probably a lot of you remember, is still a an active mailing list, and it's also really important because it's like the equivalent of net time, but for people that really care about feminist issues. And now I leave the word to her, and I thank you very much for being here today.
Yes, thank you back, Tatiana, to inviting me to moderate this panel. Thank you for the panelists being here, and also thank you for the audience that came here on this maybe last summer day. So it's very heroic of you to come here and listen to us. Just a few words as an introduction. Tatiana wrote in the catalog to the Samizdata show that one of the goals of the show is to transform the practices of whistleblowing and the fight for social justice into something more concrete, something that everybody can embody beyond the creation of a few heroes and political stars. And I think that sets the task here for today. What are the strategies for resistance, or maybe strategies for creating another society where things like mass surveillance, drone strikes, and the silencing of contradicting voices are not possible? And these are just a few issues that are on our agenda. I hope you all agree that we are living in a world at the moment where there are a lot of pressing issues and a lot of is transforming and happening on all kinds of levels. Yesterday, Jacob Applebaum said that even the heroes work inside of a structure, inside of a network that makes it possible for them to be heroes. So they are not coming from out of nowhere, but there are structures. And one of the things we are going to see talk about today are what are these structures, how do they work, how can we sustain them, build more of them, and keep them flourishing. I personally got involved in the 1990s net art and net activism, like Tatiana said. The scene then was much smaller. There were fewer people, and we kind of all knew each other, even internationally. Of course, in our scene, I say like our, but it's a bit difficult. We were kind of too clever to think that technology would save us all, but there was still a certain feeling of optimism. And this has completely changed. We moved from this feeling of optimism to a more kind of dystopian present in that we are living. Again, from the program, more than ever today is extending a grim aura over our capacity to imagine a better society. And in this panel, we will talk about how to get rid of this aura, or at least dissipate it a bit, and to find ways of acting. Our participants on the panel have multiple experiences in this area, and that will hopefully inspire you to reflect on what we can do to imagine a better society and build it. So I start with Jaromil. He's a free software programmer and media activist and media artist and activist. He published his own Linux distribution. He's also a researcher in the philosophy of technology and writes about hacking, Bitcoin, free software, and much, much more. These are some of the things that I found. I first want to introduce the other two. Yeah, okay. So here is Sophie Toupin. She's a researcher exploring the linkages between technology, feminism, and activism. She has worked with FemHack, a feminist hacker space in Montreal, and with the TransHack Feminist Project in Calafú in Spain. At the moment, she's working at Media McGill, an interdisciplinary department at the McGill University in Montreal on issues in media, technology, and culture. And last but not least, here is Jørgen Johansen, a writer, peace and conflict worker, trainer, and activist. He has written numerous books, I think some of them you find at the entrance, on resistance, civil disobedience, and social change. He was also accused for being a spy, but this is a story he will tell us about later. And of course, you are all the participants on this in this event, not just like we who are sitting here in front. So we are looking also forward to hearing from you later. But first, we will have three short presentations from here above. So Jaromil will start.
Thank you again for this introduction. I propose you today basically a very critical reflection. It's a critical reflection, first of all, for myself. Sometimes I feel it very healthy when I find myself doing something I'm very convinced about, and I'm in the middle of a lot of people that are really convinced about doing this something. I don't really like to stop to obstacle what is happening, but I always have some voice in my mind, or when I go to sleep or when I wake up. Like I think of it critically. So I think, what if I would look at this thing from the eyes of someone else? And why these people are against us? Why are we against them? And what is us and them? So I basically propose you something that is full of insecurity, my own insecurity. And I hope it's at least inspiring. It started with this sort of term that came out when talking with Tatiana. And it's a strange, it has to be angst. I think it would be angoscia in Italy. It's a strange definition of the sort of fear that we put every time we tell someone, oh my God, you have to really guard your data safely and you have to use these programs, and some are easier, some are very complex, but anyway, you have to change your workflow in order to be safe because they're watching on you. It happened to me once. I was in a squat in a social center in Italy, and we were giving this crypto basic course to people. And in the audience, most of the people had already troubles, had to deal with the police. They were in jail. They knew why they were watched. And we were there in explaining them, look, you have to change all your computers to install these fairly complex systems because they are watching on you. And they were there yeah, we know. And you have to be very careful because, you know, they watch you also after you are outside. Yeah, we know. And it felt a little bit and by the way, try to disappear because they really don't want you here, you know. It almost felt like this, hide your communications and always feel in a sort of siege of yourself, of your beliefs, of your dreams in life. And I think there is something wrong in that. And I'm not sure what is it, but perhaps we can reason about it more to make it better. Also, we live in a time in which if we look around ourselves, is what I try to define infoproletariat. There is an amazing amount of people that are out there and they are ready to give any privacy to their life, to what they do, or in certain degrees, to actually even make money, find a job. Because nowadays, an Instagram account or a Facebook account, or even better, a Twitter account, mean actually cred. You go on LinkedIn has already substituted in ICT, but not only the CV for most people that want to find a job. So actually there is a deal, there is an economic deal in giving out all your privacy. And there is people that do that because they have no other choice. It's like the last dream of finding a job is shining your bling, you too, in the cameras, as we all do, as we are also somehow a mediatized representation of this sort of economy, ourselves, on any stage you go. So there are some contradictions that are, I think, unresolved, because in the moment in which we have this sort of need for privacy, but then we have also this sort of economy, we might ask ourselves, is privacy still an issue for the masses? So there I come and I make a step back on the criticism. I think, yes, it is, because without privacy, we do not have democracy, and that might be too long to explain now, but most people in this room are familiar with this concept. Yet, there is probably a priority scale that we can put in relation to this, to privacy as one of the issues that we might want to tackle as activists in the future. My question, my answer is, this is a little bit of an answer for a question that was posed yesterday, and it's a question that is posed often. I mean, how do we involve the people out there? How do we involve the people that are, there is enough ethnical and gender diversity in this room, but still the people that are not from our context, that don't care about these digital things, and for them happen all in a different context, basically. I mean, all these people out there in Kotbussertor, walking around the shops and living their life in a very far away context from ours. What is really affecting them is probably not exactly privacy as a priority. So I try to think what are the other issues that they might feel. And I come to think, how about housing and rent? I mean, these are issues that actually put in relationship everyone, especially in the cities, in the urban settlements in which we are. And they are also connected with information. And potentially, we could even imagine a whistleblowing act into those networks. Although I would suggest it would be better to look into the history of what are the solidarity networks behind this sort of riots or this sort of fights. And they can be unions, worker unions, they can be housing associations to watch on the speculation, how it's going and how people are isolated and blocks privatized and sold, a process that we are witnessing all over Europe. These are issues that really strongly affect people out there. And sometimes when I read a lot about all this crypto angst and, oh my God, the super spies have captured that other super spy and someone is running around with a sport car bringing someone else from place to the other, it's like, it feels a little bit like a movie, and I wonder if we can bring that down to also some other contexts, down or up, it depends. And I think that by doing so, we have to do a step into this, what I call demilitarization. So let's try to actually remove the traits that are military in all what is happening. Let's try to not imagine, because privacy is something that comes to your mind immediately when you are in a very hostile situation or mildly hostile situation. You need to have confidentiality. It's very important in crisis zones, and some of us have experience of that. But in peace, let's try to imagine what can we do with this sort of information progress in peace, in times of peace. It has been difficult for us because we come from a different context. Now I talk more for the hackers world. I mean, hackers come from back in the days, back in the 80s and 90s, when we actually had all sorts of conspiracies floating through the BBSs as files, and some of them actually are turning out to be true, you know, and some people have been sort of damned by knowing these sort of truths, you know, that were so hard, and now they are televised in front of us and celebrated. And not all of them were true, but, you know, like we have Philippe G. back in the 80s that, for instance, published all these papers about all sort of traffic, drugs of war, Gladio project in Italy and in other places. They were published already by CIA operatives that were dropping out and hiding here in Hamburg, actually, in his case. So we came from this sort of narrative that is rather conspirative and has always this sort of touches of militarization, of violence, of sort of urban sense of war, which is functional to the narrative of total war. And although I really love these guys, but sometimes, you know, saying always like, yeah, we are a legion and we are coming to punish you, perhaps we could look at different narratives and different messages. We could also renew this in terms of peace, because if you don't create the space for a peaceful dialogue, then you will never make it, really. Back then, I think that we are inserted in a time in which, anyway, it's very interesting, and hackers have done a lot, even with this very turbulent, with this tormented sort of figure that is given back to us by TV series like Mr. Robot, for instance, this sort of like really tormented guys that take lots of drugs and have a lot of problems relating with others. Actually, I don't think it's an exact picture of the hacker as we want to have it, and we should, and as we should have it. I mean, people have very different interests, and hackers are not just obsessed by their security job in a corporate sector or not. And especially, we are in touch with very older stories and very older, much older heritages. This is a picture from a movement from the 70s, Renudo in Italy, which is something I quote mostly for the name. It's like it's referencing the emperor's new clothes. And I use this just to show you like how we live in a time in which some sort of ideas that were already developed back then are realizing themselves. We are seeing the emperor being naked in front of us. There are several truths that are out there. There are political movements that based on a concept as old as parresia, as like the fool that says everything. There are already political movements that are building a critical mass based on these sort of concepts. Presence of the Movimento Cinque Stelle in Italy, for instance, it's very much based on that. Grillo always had this sort of very parretic comicity and in his TV shows before becoming a politician. And it's like this sort of attitude of saying everything because we have, someone has to say it, and you know, people will follow you, and it, you know, it became also pop in a way, but it's there for a change, for creating a change, and the change is usually an empty throne. It's like this void of power that we are creating by doing all these sort of revelations, and how do we fill it with is the main question that we really have to pose ourselves in the moment in which we are thinking of creating a society and institutions and encouraging people to enter institutions, to enter organizations, and change them. And so here I resonates, I don't know, I have five more minutes probably or something. Here resonates one call that Jake made yesterday, which I think could be transformed slightly, just as a new interpretation to it, when he says, like, yeah, it's good to actually infiltrate organizations, to change them as they are. I think this exhortation could have like a sort of, it could have a more militarized sort of accent, but it could also not have this accent, because in the same time in which he was saying that, in my mind, I was thinking of Gandhi when he said, you have to be the change that you want to see in the world. And so in the moment in which you think that an organization is going really, really bad, you either create another organization or enter this organization and really for changing it. So the first objective maybe is not exactly that of blowing a whistle because it's going bad, but anyway, participating in a network of power which is likely going to open up in the future in many of the institutions that we are criticizing. And so you see that also the representation of technology could become a little bit less conflictual. In this project that we are, and here I bring on some short examples of things that I'm trying to do with our collective and some people online. I mean, we are very dislocated. With one project, we are trying to do a router for the Internet of Things, for this sort of scenario of total war that is the Internet of Things, in which we will have a lot more objects in our home running and doing and exchanging data back and forth with the huge industrial silos. And in doing that, we could have called it a firewall, because in fact it is. It's a layer 2 and layer 3 firewall. We could have called it a shield to defend yourself. But actually, we are trying hard to change all these words, and we call this act dowsing, as in looking for water or with a stick or with a pendulum, something that is not really aggressive. It's like a way to look for network or to know where your network comes from. And we are trying hard, and it's very, very difficult to change every single word of this process and of the interface and of what we're doing with something that is not a militarized concept of defending yourself from the attack, from the threat outside. It's not super easy, actually. And that's the name of the project. Another project that we're trying to do, and I think we have good chances to adapt it in future, is called FreeCoin. And it's basically coming from the experience that we had on the Bitcoin blockchain already back in 2011, when the project was extremely politicized. And actually, I argue, it took off from the financial blockade of WikiLeaks. There are reasonable proofs of that on the history of the blockchain and its usage. And now we are, 5 years later, we are seeing that the corporations are already forking this project into Bitcoin XT. They are like changing technical parts, inserting block lists. They are changing it so that it can serve the industry. And I'm seeing a lot of comrades into this sort of project going just to work for free, even with enthusiasm, for a use that is actually the use of the corporations, of the bankers. It reminds me of privacy sometimes, because I see people, you know, like using privacy tools that are developed, and of course open source and free software, in contexts in which, for which I would have never worked, or even less worked for free. So I think that we are trying to appropriate this narrative of money, that is mostly the attempt that is going on, and we are building a social wallet that we define based on social proof of work, so connected to various democracy tools that are around in a larger cluster of a project called Decent, standing for decentralized citizen engagement technologies. And the dream is that of empowering people with creating network of values, of trust, and that are resilient and therefore also rely on the blockchain. So it's a little bit abstract and technical in this regard, but basically imagine the empowerment that we had so far with all the internet and with all this info communication. It's coming also to the realm of money and value transactions, and we are trying to keep it at least developed in a sense, in an application that is not for the industry and is not for the corporations. Because believe it or not, any technical innovation just goes into that. You know, it has like a huge application. People are talked into producing their ideas also in a massified, in a scaled way. We are entangled by all these startup sort of narratives, so that as soon as you have a brilliant idea, you have to have a business plan and you have to go out there and realize it and sell it. We're trying to step aside from that and see if it happens also without having immediately a business plan in mind, which will change the idea itself. And I think I conclude with this. Perhaps we should have, coming back to the whistleblowing, a way maybe to think it or rethink it better is to individuate a critical moment in which the whistleblowing becomes a, once again, a one-to-many communication, as it is nowadays, as more and more is becoming. Like, we are imagining these heroes, individuals, that can do a one-to-many revelation, and it's exactly like old media architectures in which we had a TV that was telling us the truth. And of course, the truth is like this extremely complex concept that we won't talk about it now, but and you can make up your idea of the truth, but let's try to envision always architectures in which we don't have this one-to-many, and we have a sort of more peer-to-peer approach, or many-to-many, and that can be reinforced with trust. And my argument is that probably unions, if they would have delivered what they really wanted to, the worker unions, are at least a formulation, an institutional formulation that should have covered this role. Thank you.
So should I jump in? Okay, hello. So I'm going to be speaking about a research that I have been conducting in the past 8 months. The research is not yet finished, but I'm going to share what I have with you so far. And so it is about one of the most exciting case study that I found. And it is a case study that shed lights on anti-colonial hacking. It's a term that I've been using, and then I'm going to explain why I've been using this term. And I think the case study really is a piece of, it helps to understand a piece of history of resistance and of agency, which is about, you know, the topic of this conversation that we're having today. So basically, it is the story of anti-apartheid activist who in the 1980s crafted and operated an autonomous encrypted communication network that enabled operatives infiltrated in South Africa to communicate directly with the ANC, so the African National Congress leadership in exile in Zambia, via London, UK. So this, this network was born at a time when the computer was just emerging. We're in the middle of the 1980s, where cryptography was still viewed as a weapon by many countries, so the crypto war had not yet happened. And also when countries such as the United States were actually boycotting the sale of computers to South Africa, because it was deemed as operating and automating apartheid. So the communication network was part of Operation Vula, an operation that was launched in the 1980s, and which basically aimed at destructuring and dismantling the apartheid regime that had been legally implemented in South Africa since 1948. Operation Vula really wanted to put an end to apartheid regime by bringing in some ANC leaders through to the country to basically foster what they called a people's war. And Operation Vula means open the path, open the road in Zulu. And it was really envisaged at a time when the context on the ground was very, very difficult. There were operatives and cadres, or what we could call today activists, who were forced into exile, who were being arrested, who were jailed, who were tortured, and who were assassinated, who were killed. So the context on the ground was very, very difficult. So it's in that context and in those conditions that this autonomous encrypted communication network was born. So if we back up, you know, like a few years before the communication network was created, we need to remember that the ANC was sending a few operatives in South Africa that were well trained and that were skilled. And one of these operatives was a late 20-year-old tech-savvy white South African named Tim Jenkin. And before his political consciousness was born, and that pushed him to be part of the ANC, Tim Jenkin was not fully aware of the brutality of the apartheid regime in South Africa, even if he had grown up there, even if he, you know, he was born there. And in his book, Escape from Pretoria, he really says the difficulty for South Africans back in the time to be fully aware of the web of privileges and racism that that existed. And so for him, his political consciousness was really raised through reading books. So he started devouring books, especially when he was out of South Africa. As a white South African, he could travel. And so that's where his political consciousness was raised, because we have to understand that in South Africa there were a lot of books that were banned. So lots of books that were critical about the apartheid regime, books about socialism, about Marxism, about, you know, any kind of critical book were banned in South Africa. So having one's political consciousness raised was actually not an easy. It was not easy. And so after working clandestinely for 2 years in Cape Town, he was printing and distributing ANC material to wake up South Africans, particularly white South Africans, to the cause of the ANC. So he was arrested and jailed under terrorist charges, and he was jailed for what was called leaflet bombing. And so leaflet bombing, in a nutshell, it's basically a little time bomb device that he had been taught to create and to use, which would do no harm to people, but would launch into the air, really like send into the air pamphlets about the ANC and its cause. And so he was jailed for leaflet bombing under, you know, terrorist charges for, you know, for just like sending pamphlets into the air. And these pamphlets were basically reminders of the brutality of the apartheid regime. For instance, every year on the 21st of March, they reminded themselves of a massacre that happened, the Sharpeville massacre that happened in 1960, where black South Africans who were marching in the streets against a new law that had been passed, a pass law that really made them second-class citizens, were brutally murdered, and many of them were children, and they were trying to flee the police, but the police opened fire while they were fleeing, so they were shot in the back. So the leaflet bombing was trying to remind people of such events that happened, and the brutality, the extreme brutality of the apartheid regime. And so when Tim Jenkin and another colleague of his was arrested, as soon as he was arrested, he decided that he would escape, or he would try to escape from prison. So in a meticulously planned escape, doing lockpicking. So for those who know lockpicking, it's a really, if you go to a hacker conference, you would have a lockpicking workshop. For sure, that would be organized. So doing lockpicking, he basically succeeded after a year and a half in opening 10 doors. So what he did during the day to lockpick, he would basically craft in the wood workshop of the prison 10 different sets of keys. And while, you know, crafting these keys and trying them at night or during daytime, he succeeded in escaping. So this is an amazing story in itself. There's a documentary that was done on this by the National Geographic magazine. So if some of you are interested, I highly recommend it. It's amazing. It's unbelievable. So highly recommended. And so after escaping from prison, he went to the UK in London, and he started to be a communication officer. And so he would train people in covert operations. And at the same time, what he did is he started experimenting with programming and with cryptography with another colleague of his, an exiled South African chemistry professor named Ronnie Press. And so both of them would read books on programming, read books on cryptography, and just like try to figure it out and really experiment on the first available laptops available in Britain at that time. And just to situate people in a timeline, we're roughly in the years of 1984 and 1985, so it's really, really early. It's earlier than the cypherpunks in the United States. And so until the beginning of the 1980s, the ANC did not rely on a sophisticated use of communication. So what the ANC was using was basically a foot courier that would go in and out of the country and bring instructions, bring pamphlets, bring different kind of material. So you can imagine that it took time. It was also very dangerous. And a lot of women were actually foot courier. And the ANC was also using radio, so pirate forms of radio at the beginning, but afterwards they were broadcasting from different countries in Africa, mostly from Tanzania, and they were broadcasting revolutionary narrative that people in South Africa could listen, and it would bring hope to them that things are still, you know, happening, and that the ANC is still there, still cares, and just listening the broadcast in South Africa, if you were a black South African, you could be arrested just for listening to the broadcast. The ANC also resorted to handwritten cryptography. And so these were like messages, coded messages that, you know, you would write by hand, and just handwritten cryptography takes a long time. So even though some of the operative and cadres were using that kind of cryptography, handwritten cryptography, it often took 24, 48 hours to decipher a message and the same time to decipher it. So when Tim Jenkins and Ronnie Press created and crafted this autonomous communication network that I'm going to show you right now with an infographics, you can imagine that the time to communicate, you know, it rendered the communication way more effective. So let me now just show you the communication network. Okay. So we see, yes. So we see the infographic, and the infographic was made by Ariel Acevedo, so I need to thank him, with the contribution of the Office of Quebec in Berlin. And so you see four blocks, four major blocks, and the four major blocks are basically four different countries. So the ABC is South Africa, the D is the UK, the E is Zambia, and then the one without letters is actually is the Netherlands. So how would it work? How would the system, the autonomous encrypted communication system, work? So the first thing that I can say is that it was an assemblage of technology. So different kind of devices were used to craft this system. So if we start, let's start with the Netherlands. And why I'm starting with the Netherlands, and Amsterdam in particular, is that there was the anti-apartheid movement, the Dutch anti-apartheid movement, that was very important in this communication network. And so Connie Brown, an important figure of the Dutch anti-apartheid movement, recruited a Dutch flight attendant named Antoinette. And she would be the mule. So she would basically infiltrate equipment, computer laptops, encrypted disk in South Africa. And at that time, there was no security check for the crew. So she could bring in a lot of equipment. She could bring some money. She could bring, you know, she was very, very useful. And so if we look at on the right-hand side, the number B, and I'm going to zoom in so that you can actually read what's written. So there would be Janet Love, and Janet Love was actually a NC cadre that was the third person to be infiltrated during Operation Vula in South Africa. And so Janet Love would write a message in a safe house in South Africa, let's say in Johannesburg. So she would write the message on the computer that she wanted to send. And then through the serial port of the computer, it would go through the acoustic coupler modem, and an acoustic coupler modem is basically a device that allows digital data to be translated into an audio stream. And so the audio stream would then be recorded on the tape recorder. So Janet Love would bring the cassette tape to another office somewhere else in Johannesburg, in an office with or without the knowledge of the owner, and she would phone Tim Jenkins in London, and she would play the tape recorder onto the mouthpiece of the phone, and so there would be the humming sound that would go through the telephone system, the beep, you know, the humming sound, and so that would be picked up in London by an answering machine, and the answering machine would, you know, record it, and then Tim Jenkins in London would do the same thing. That is, from the answering machine, it would go through the acoustic modem coupler, and then go through, be deciphered, and then be written on the screen as plain text. And so once, and we can see it here, and so once Tim Jenkins would see the message on the computer, he would then decide what to do with the message. So if it was a message that needed to be sent to the ANC leadership in exile in Zambia, then he would do the same process and send it to another Dutch national named Lucia, who had also been recruited by Connie Brown, the Dutch anti-apartheid movement director. And so Lucia, during 3 years of her life, what she did is that she was sitting in an office and she was receiving and deciphering the messages. And she would print them, and then a courier would come and take the messages and bring them to the ANC leadership, who were in the know about Operation Vula, so that they could decide what to do with the message. So sometimes the messages could be, we need more money because we need to buy such and such things, or we need detonators, or we need, there could be different kind of messages that that would be sent. And so I think I'm going to stop there. And so you have an idea of how the system worked. And so maybe later on we will be able to, if you have more questions about the system, I'll be happy to, respond to your questions. Thank you.
Okay, we have now the third input. By Jürgen, just a short switch for the...
Hi. Since the topic is building strategies, when I've been studying strategies, I find two places where they are quite well developed, and that's in business communities and military academies. And they build their strategies on experiences from the past combined with new ideas. I'm sorry to say, but in those 100 countries plus I've been working, I don't see social movements having the understanding of their own history. That's why I would spend my 20 minutes here to reflect a little on what social movements have achieved and what should be a basis for our strategy for the future. First of all, there are some roots, quite recent ones, that I find extremely valuable to understand and to learn from. Resistance is to challenge powers in all different contexts. When you are at school, it is your teachers. Before that, it's your parents. Then it's your professors at university, your bosses in your jobs. You find power relations everywhere, and very few of them are just power relations. They need resistance because they are unjust. Injustices is what is maybe the most typical face of our societies today. Not only in recent dates with refugees coming to Europe or whatever. In every place of the world you find injustices. And it's very often accepted by obedient people. And that's a serious problem for all of us. We need to reveal stupidity. People in power are quite frequently stupid. And they make stupid decisions, and we accept it. And that's a problem for all of us as well. Truth-telling, some call it whistleblowing, is something we have seen some famous cases on the top level in the recent years. That must be developed to be used much more among ordinary people, in every workplace, in every university, in every foundation. There are truths to be told that is not public today. People who get access to information that should be public must be trained to make them public. I'm coming back to that a little later. Protecting privacy, it was excellently explained here, the importance of that. Of course, the most frequent comment I get from my students when I'm lecturing about the privacy topics is, I have nothing to hide, so I don't care. And we really need to challenge that reply, I have nothing to hide. Of course, it's not true. Everyone has something to hide, and we should have. But we shouldn't mix privacy with secrecies. Privacy is something different than secrecies. I will come back to that when I talk about another topic in a few minutes. Publish what those in power hide to fool us. I was born in Scandinavia a long time ago. And the Scandinavian countries have a tendency to pretend to be so nice and democratic. They've been fooling all of us. It's just the facade, the face that is maybe looking nice. Behind that, they are ugly as every other state. I have an example of that coming up very soon. People are afraid of conflicts. Conflicts has been my main focus since I was very young. And my conclusion is we need to escalate them. Not with violence, but with peaceful means. We need to develop new techniques to escalate conflicts, to make them visible, and to use them to inform people and to organize movements around them. Campaigning. You mentioned the unions, and they have a long history of campaigning. And very few of us know enough about that story, how they did it. We maybe know the surface of it, but not really the deeper understanding of the decisions they took and how they organized and how they were able to mobilize. We need less civil obedience. I am one of those who has been done a lot of civil disobedience. My first arrest when I was 14. I've been arrested in more than 15 countries. And when I come to Northern Europe these days, I see a massive movement of civil obedient people. And I fear we are very close to the same level of obedience as you saw in Germany in the 1920s. That's the most serious threat to democracy in Europe today, is this fucking obedient people who always follow orders, whoever tells them whatever to do. In order to be effective, you need to organize. You could have the best of intentions for yourself, but if you don't join with more people, you are a very weak actor on the scene. So organizing, and that needs skills. That's nothing you just know how to do. You must be trained and educated to organize. Is this mine? That was mine, sorry. I very often find people with the best of intentions. And that's good, we need good intentions. But without the skills, it could be quite dangerous. In best case, useless. I find that in all conflict areas, when I'm in Palestine or in Chechnya or in Colombia or in wherever I'm going, I find all these young, white Europeans, North Americans with the best of intentions. But they're lacking the skills how to act in a complex conflict. And they're doing a lot of stupid and even harming the local people quite frequently. So we need to have some sort of education, some sort of training, some sort of skills. If I want to build a house, I can't ask someone with good intentions. I need a good builder to do that. And we want to build campaigns where everyone can participate. You don't need to be highly educated or expert on computers or whatever other skills. We need to find campaigns and strategies where everyone can find a place and contribute to the campaign. Not an exclusive elite campaign. We have seen too much of that. Strategies are important. I find them very seldom being developed to a sufficient level. Very often they are completely lacking. People take to the streets, they are demanding things, and they hope that someone will listen to them, but they are lacking a long-term strategy. Without that, we will fail too often. Those we are opposing, they have strategies. They have long-term planning for how to cope with us. And we need to have at least the same level of strategies that those in power have. In order to build that, we need documentation. I want every activist to document what she or he is doing so we could learn from them when we build the new campaigns. I'm sometimes invited to war academies, and the officers in the war academies, they know every single military battle since the wars of Napoleon on their five fingers. And they learn from every single battle what to do differently next time. And their goal is to kill more people. But we want to create a better world. But we need to have the same documentation of our own history so we could build on that when we plan the next strategy. Documentation is extremely important, and they should have evaluations. What went well? What was wrong? What was stupid? And then you could, in your next campaign, do a much better job. If you don't do documentation, you will find every new generation starting on square one. I find my son doing the same stupid mistakes I did when I was 15 today, because I haven't done my job to telling him about my own history. So we need to be better on documentation and doing evaluations. One of the things with Norway, on the ugly faces of Norway, is that when Norway joined NATO, they promised to have two exceptions from ordinary membership, namely no nuclear bombs in peacetime and no foreign military bases. And that was what the government told the population and the parliament agreed on, and that went on for many, many years, until a small group of pacifists, I was one of them, started to collecting information about military bases in Norway. And we could, after 5 years of searching for evidence of foreign bases and nuclear bombs, publish this map with 13 American bases, 7 of them with nuclear arsenals. And of course, the government went mad. It was the first police raid against a journal in Norway since Quisling was the prime minister against us, and we were accused of spying. 5 years later, I was found not guilty, but it was with 3-2 votes in the Supreme Court. So very, very close. And these things of revealing what the government want to hide from us is extremely important, that every government is lying to us. I'm not saying they're lying every time, but every government lies when they have something to hide. And it's our task to get to the true story. And we need to have some patience. It's not done in a quick fix. It's not like American fast food to do a good campaign. I was part of a campaign in Sweden when they agreed to find a place for storing nuclear waste. Nuclear waste must be taken care of for at least 100,000 years. And that's a long time. It's only 2,000 years since Jesus was born. It's only 5,000 years since the pyramids were built. It's only 10,000 years since the Ice Age. It's only 40,000 years since the Neanderthals were walking around in Berlin. I mean, 100,000 years. The politicians were telling you we have a safe storage plan. They are lying to you. There is no way they could have a guarantee for 100,000 years to come. We occupied the construction site in April 1980. And we promised we will stay here 24/7 until you stop these plans. And they came in February 2000. We stayed on that site 19 years, 10 months, 24/7. That's a sustainable campaign. Both my kids were probably created on that site. It was part of our social life to stay there from 6 in the morning to 6 in the afternoon, to 6 in the afternoon to 6 in the morning, 12-hour shifts for 19 years and 10 months. That is sometimes necessary to stay put for a long time. Don't expect to have a quick fix. We won't completely, for that mountain was saved. Here is the symbol of our campaign. Whistleblowing, truth-telling. I know that was the topic of yesterday, partly. But as it was mentioned yesterday, we shouldn't only focus on these exceptional cases that we have seen on mainstream media in recent years. This must be part of our daily lives. We need to do this in every context where you are facing secrets that those in power doesn't want to be well known. It should be a normal way to act. Every employer, and I want to go back to your trade unions again, they should have courses for the members how to act in a wise way when you are confronted with secrets the employers or the government doesn't want us to know about. For all of us who detect stupidity, injustices, human wrongs, or whatever, I am running a small publishing house. Here's my ad for the day. This book is a practical guide that should be read before you blow the whistle. So you know how to make a strategy, how to protect yourself and be effective when you're blowing the whistle. There are some copies down on the entrance here for sale. But that type of information must be widely distributed long before you blow the whistle. Otherwise, you are in deep shit. I've been talking to so many of these ordinary people who've been blowing the whistle, and they have mental problems, they are harassed, and they are losing their jobs, they are losing their houses. Serious problems for all of them, because they haven't been planning it in advance. And they think, if I tell the truth, everyone will understand. But you need a strategy to blow the whistle in a wise way. When I was 18, I got a letter from the government. I was invited for 1 year training in how to handle conflicts. And I said, no, thank you, because the training was the military system. It was a conflict between the state and an individual, in this case, Norway versus Jørgen. And I was part of a small group of activists who want to challenge that system. In Norway in the 1970s, you got 16 months in prison for refusing military service. And you were put there together with people who have been committing killings and murders. And of course, when you are in prison and your neighboring cell is the man who has killed someone, and you are there because you refuse to kill, that creates some thoughts in your head, okay? The government punished those who kill and those who refuse to kill. So we planned actions against that law. We wanted to think outside the box. And this is why I use this example. We need to think outside what is done before by other people. We wanted to use humor. We wanted to have people laughing at injustices. And we wanted to use creativity. Very different styles of actions than what has been done before. Maybe it could be an inspiration. The story is, I was arrested several times when I was in the teens, and I always used the same lawyer. He became a very good friend of mine. And one day he called me and said, Jørgen, I think you are right. I will refuse military service as well. Yes, one more. I was so happy. And then he said, well, my court case is coming up in 2 weeks. Could you help me? And I said, well, can't you defend yourself? You're a lawyer by profession, and you've had hundreds of these cases before. Yeah, but I don't want you to be my lawyer, he said. I want you to be my prosecutor. Prosecutor? How could I be the prosecutor? can't we try? He said. So on the morning of that day, when his court case was coming up, I called the real prosecutor and I pretended to be from the court. And I said, the case is delayed for 2 weeks due to sickness. So he never turned up. And that made it easy for me to replace him. I went up to his office and I stole one of these black robes. And I went into the courtroom and presented myself. I was prepared to be kicked out. But the judge said, welcome. Are you new here? Yeah, pretty new. Well, take your seat. And I went on for 4 hours and pretended to be a very conservative, reactionary prosecutor. When even lawyers refused military service, we should double the punishment. In the audience, we had two with a hidden camera. So next day, we went, first of all, after four hours, the judge said, a decision will be taken next week. So the next day, we went to the media in Norway, and I got all the headlines in every national newspaper, and on TV, and on radio stations, to explain our situation who refused military service. Everyone was laughing. And I was accused for two things, disrespect for the court and pretending to be a public officer. And that gives a minimum of 3 months imprisonment for these two crimes. After half a year, the case was decided on by sending me a letter saying, the case is laid down due to lack of evidence. So I appealed, I sent a letter where I confessed, and a copy of the video we had taken. But they refused me back in court. The next step in this campaign was against the prison system. To be in prison, I mean, Norway has better standards than Israel or China or Turkey. But still, you are locked up for 16 months. So when one of us were in prison, we went to the prison, and we had ladders and ropes, and we climbed into the prison, and we demanded to be in prison together with him, because he was there due to his conviction, and we had the same conviction. So when we jumped over the walls, the alarm went up, and the guards came out screaming. The boss came out after some time, and he called for the police, but didn't dare to take the police inside the prison. What are you doing here, he said. Well, we want to be imprisoned. Get out. And this prison is full. We could share rooms, I said. We could sleep on the floors. No way, get out. And in the end, he sent the police in, and I was arrested, and I was carried out of the prison. And I was accused for illegal entrance into private property. To make the story very short, 2 years later, they changed the law from 16 months imprisonment to 6 weeks. A pretty good development for us. My summary is, we need more research and development on how to resist, how to be a good activist. There is a serious deficit of research and development when it comes to expanding the toolbox for activists. Too many activists have too small toolboxes, with just a few tools to be used when they are in a conflict. Too little time and resources are spent on developing new creative ideas. We are too much repeating what was done 20, 40, 60, 100 years ago. And that's not good enough. We need to test out new ideas. Some would fail, of course. We do stupid things, but documenting it and learning from it, and you could build a stronger movement. I get depressed when I see every new generation starting from square one. There are too many of them who hasn't the story of the social movements, women's movement, environmental movement, peace movement, all of them starting from scratch, every new generation popping up. I developed a fora for academical research and discussions. We have a copy here of a new journal. But I hope that some of you who are activists and academics will be able to share with us your research on how to resist. Much more is needed. We have two options: being a part of the problems in the world or trying to be part of the solutions. There's no third option. If you are just an observer, you are part of the problem. Thank you.
Thank you, all of you. We had like really great examples and strategies like we saw them here. I start with some questions on the panel and then I open up for you in the audience. So you have a little bit of time to think of for questions. One thing that I noticed is we had yesterday a question from the audience that kind of contrasted whistleblowing and digital activists against real political work. You today mentioned, or both of you mentioned, unions as one of the examples of existing strategies or existing things that from the past. Could you maybe start and elaborating a bit more? How do you think concretely can we learn from unions? How can we use them? Because I know, especially from the freelance movement, and a lot of us here are freelancers, that we don't really feel represented by unions.
Well, I think, I mean, as a theoretical passage, it's rather simple. I guess it's trying to reach the multitude, the dimension of the multitude on which much more than I can say now was written on, so a more collective dimension, and then of solidarity and protection. And the examples are very simple. In my life, I knew many workers that tried to step up for their rights or were mobbed by the bosses. And in the moment in which they come out about this, they are isolated. And I know cases in which unionists, so people running unions, were mobbed because they were the organizers. And I'm sure that many of people here can relate to this sort of stories. Like if you have anyone in the family or yourself work in a worker chain, in a factory, in a big factory. So out of these examples, I think that it can be brought into this new dimension. There are particular examples, as far as I know, from Italy, like San Precario, the experience of San Precario. So also with a very joyful approach, the generation of this saint, which is the saint that was missing, the saint of the precarious people. Because, you know, you have in Christianity, you have saints for many, depending from what is your work, you know, for your work, employment and role. And so people said that because precarious people, they have to be ready to do everything. They missed a saint, basically. So there was this invention, and people were out on procession. You know, it was a pop attitude. But behind this sort of different strategies of marketing, it was a union for people that were precarized. So people started going through the McDonald's, the shops that actually we would never enter as consumers, most of us. And trying to ask people what were their conditions and what was their contract, and trying to make them aware of laws that now are getting deleted completely, unfortunately, about their rights. And I think that in these situations, if there is something going wrong in the terms of worker rights, people are really quickly isolated, and there is no possibility really to do this sort of telling the truth, this sort of whistleblowing. The solidarity is very difficult to build. And, well, perhaps more people have examples of movements that have been created.
I see the unions as being important, but far from sufficient in building campaigns. Few of us are members, too few, and some can't be member because you're not having a job. But we are all consumers. And I would rather see a combination of consumer organizations with the workers' organizations, because even if you are unemployed or you are in a hospital or you are in a prison, you are still a consumer. And you see, all the economical powers are trying to get rid of producers, the workers. They are using computers and robots and whatever, but they can't get rid of consumers. If you all stop buying McDonald's garbage food, they're out of business. So the consumer role has been tested in a few boycott campaigns, but very, very elementary job is done so far. I see hopes in the future for better organized consumer campaigns. That goes against the Macintosh or the IBM computers or whatever. When we have good alternatives, we could stop supporting these stupid companies, these bad companies. And they are dependent on us. Every time you buy in the shop, you are an obedient consumer. But you could make a choice, buy something different. And we have been looking into combining boycotts with girlcotts. Boycott is to refuse buying stuff. Girlcott is to promote the good local produced food or whatever. The opposite of boycotting, namely to help those who are trying to come up with good alternatives. And there are options here to develop better ideas based on your role as a consumer.
So I'm going to say something, I guess, continuing on the historical path. I think there are amazing examples of trade unions in the past, particularly the Wobblies in the United States, the international workers of the world, who use sabotage tactics in the early 20th century. And they were inspired by the Luddites, who were seeing with the Industrial Revolution their craft just going away. And so they were breaking machines. And so sometimes, counter to popular belief, when we say that someone is a Luddite, it's actually not someone who's afraid of technology. It's someone who is ready to break certain technology that oppresses them. So I think it's a very interesting concept to think about, you know, breaking machines in some ways.
Can I complete the range also of scenarios? It comes to my mind about the housing, which I think I really identify as one of the emergencies in Europe to come, even considering how many people are wanting to come to Europe. And you know, there is a lot of speculation. Actually, the market of houses is like insanely priced right now, and it's going up and up here in Berlin, I'm sure. You have a speed of increasing prices that you perceive very easily. And imagine to have a group of people that is pretty aware of these dynamics. In Amsterdam, we have the SPOC, the Spekulantenonderzoek, which is a sort of private investigative group that decides to research on speculation, so accessing the cadaster as you can publicly and trying to find out who is buying the biggest objects, and then linking it with the street dynamic, because you could go there down the street and see what is really happening in the block. And often you will see that many of the people that have social housing, that they are there from longer time, they are sort of pushed out in many possible ways, sometimes even harassed, to leave the object so that it can be built a new house by the speculator that has bought it. And in these sort of situations, you have a lot to do. You could even find ways to actually get into the house and have a place. But also unionizing the people that live there instead of separating, which is what actually most buyers, more speculators do, by putting them in contact and organizing a little bit more their rights, this can be overcome, and actually we can keep the prices of the neighborhoods lower this way. I mean, if you scale this sort of process, and these are renting associations also, so you don't even need to be investigating.
Maybe back to your example a bit, because I have a question there. Could you maybe say some things? You kind of presented what happened there. Maybe what would be the things that you think we could learn from this case study that we saw there?
because I felt that was cut a bit short. So.
Yeah, so what can we learn from the autonomous encrypted communication network that was developed? I think, and something that I did not necessarily mention is that there were very few people who were actually involved in crafting and operating the system. So there were about 10 people that were like top 10 level people that were creating and operating the system. And so there was a network of trust that was created. And so that's, I would say that's one important, very important dimension. Another dimension would be that the system was, you know, it was embedded in a social movement. It was embedded, the goal was not that technology would bring social progress. It was not in a frame of technological determinism. It was really in a frame of we needed to end apartheid. And so to end apartheid, we would try different actions to really, you know, have this common goal, this collective goal. And so I see this example as really anchored in a form of collectivist rights or collectivism, African collectivism. And I think going back to this collectivity as well. There was a question last night, the last question that was asked was about this collective aspect. And I think that's something that we also constantly need to factor in when we're involved in different actions, is what is the bigger picture? And I think the bigger picture is important to motivate and also to have a specific goal to achieve.
Okay, so now you have some time to think of questions. I'm opening up the floor, but before we start talking, I want to say that I want to point out that we will give precedence to other voices here. So if other voices meaning not white and male, because in this kind of context it's often that we have a certain type of people talking. So that doesn't mean that if you are a guy, you are not supposed to talk, but we will look that women, people of color, migrants will talk first. So just to say that you're not wondering why you have to wait. It's not first come, first serve today. First come, first serve. Okay, questions. Oh. Diana.
Hello. Thanks. I'm sorry, I didn't follow all of the presentations, but thanks for this, looks like really great thing. I wanted to ask about political consciousness versus individualism and how you can create maybe something, if Dima was here, I think he would talk about class consciousness and that how can you have a collective approach if you still have too many people that prefer to be their individual unique selves? And yeah, that's, and I would also suggest maybe people take a look over at Kati & Co. if you want to see a really amazing anti-gentrification campaign in action in Berlin. So, but basically I'm asking, how do you, because none of this can happen if there's not a stronger sense of class consciousness and maybe a better relationship of politics.
Should I reply? I think it's a learning process, and it's about observation. Because I also come from housing, it's a very simple observation. I mean, we are all related to that. And so if you start an anti-gentrification campaign, you really immediately see that people have a common interest, at least, on which you can work. And also, it's very easy to understand that because the house is a huge block in which we all have apartments, if we unite, we have a standing point. So there is an incentive. Sadly enough, yeah, we live in a very individualistic sort of culture, so it's easier for people to think of their own always convenience. But when it's matched with an incentive, when it's clear that there is one. Still, this is not the subjectivity, the sort of subjectivity that is described in books like Commonwealth or Multitude, in this sort of literature. And I think it's there that we can find more inspiration for observing. When I read that that the attempt is to create new forms of rationalities and new forms of liberation, I read that we have to be listening for these new forms, that they are not yet there. So perhaps they are not the old values in which we are looking for that have deluded us already as, oh, okay, people is individualist about that. But there might be new dimensions that to be discovered.
Well, that's a great question. Thank you, Diana, for raising that difficult, complex question. What we often note is that whenever there's sexism that happens, those who raise consciousness about it can be feminist, queer, trans, and when there are issues of racism that need to be addressed, they are raised by indigenous people and people of color. So how can we how can we change this? Why is it that it is often and always the same people who need to address certain issues? I think we need to seriously and collectively think about a way to challenge this, because it's very tiring to have to always be the voice of speaking about, you know, sexist issues or racist issues or class issues. So how can we collectively, you know, educate each other, and how can we individually as well realize that these issues need to be of high importance for any social movement that is being created? It's a question that I'm asking.
Yes, I have also a question I wanted to ask to Jørgen. And I have to say, I really enjoy your presentation. I think it was really hilarious to see the way you combine strategies of resistance also with sabotage, civil disobedience, and whistleblowing. And I also wanted to ask you something, because by looking at the things you do, especially the one in court, really remind me of the action of some artist, the Yes Men. I don't know if you know them. Yeah. And so I was starting to reflect about that. And of course, you did the things much before them. But you are not defining these as an artistic practice, while instead they do. And so I wanted also to challenge a bit this connection, because if we would define art as also a form of infiltration, and when, for example, I speak about disruption, I always speak about something that interferes from within. I would really, you know, engage in draw this connection between also how disobedience or sabotage could become an artistic practice. I wonder also how you came up of doing that, because, for example, if you see the documentaries of the Yes Men, by also defining it as art, they always speak about a strong strategy and aesthetic, on, you know, a big reflection of how to come up on certain things. I think also you were saying that to do certain action, you should have really clear what are the resistance you want to create and achieve, and also what are your strategies. And so my question would also be, when you were doing this thing in court, where you actually doing it by yourself, how did you conceive that? Because of course you need also to create a narrative. And I wonder if you also did this sort of meta reflection in a sort of artistic practice in realizing a certain outcome, or which kind of context was based on.
A lot of questions.
Yeah, sorry, but it was really inspiring.
Let me try to answer shortly. We were a small group of people, both genders, who were focusing on this issue. We were very much aware that we had a lack of creativity in our normal practice as activists. And we were looking around, who are the creative minds? And of course, you find artists, people writing poetry or whatever. And when I, after all these 40 years, 45 years since I was starting my activist life, when I look back, I see that there is more creativity in young people than elderly people. At 5 years old, much more creativity than after 15 years old, because the school system is destroying your creativity. I find much more creativity among artists than among diplomats. I find much more creativity, at least in average, among female than male. And since the world is run by elderly male diplomats, we are in deep shit. So what I would like us to see is we need to invite people who have more open-minded headsets on them. And we need to look outside the traditional style of activism. And we need to spend time on it. We need to test out new ways of acting and take that seriously. We are too much focusing on the topics of our campaigns, the issues. We also need to have the toolbox developed. And someone needs to do that and share their experiences with the rest of us. New tools are in high demand. I have a little secret to tell you. I very often go to arms exhibitions in London or Saudi Arabia. And I do it because I find it fascinating how these arms factories are coming up with new ways of killing people all the time. The creativity is much, much higher than in the social movements. Of course, they use it for a very bad purpose, but they are much more creative in coming up with new types of bombs and missiles and God knows what. And I would like to see some of that into the peace movement, the social movement of environmental issues, whatever. We don't have that. And it's not a question about money. I think even money could be a problem if you want to be more creative. So we need to take it seriously as an agenda in itself to develop the toolbox outside focusing on the issues you are facing.
Money might not be a problem, but as far as I go with you know, my experience, I think at least time it is, the time and the place where to live. And I think that then a solution, and I'd like to just land this political step here, is the basic income campaign. Because creativity is true. You don't actually foster creativity by giving a bunch of money to one single project, which is an excellence among many projects. Creativity is done also of empty days, of free time, and of a research that doesn't need to be stressed by business plans or an industry or a creative industry. So I would say a way out is basic income.
I'll start just quickly with a story, and then I have a question, and then I'd like to invite whether someone in the audience or on stage to give me a positive example. So I'll start with the first. I recently came back from Johannesburg. I'm a human rights researcher. I interviewed activists, men and women activists, across 8 informal settlements across Johannesburg. And one of the stories that was shocking people at the time, particularly women activists, was that this famous activist with, he's a housing activist now with deep roots in anti-apartheid movement building and activism. The General is his nickname. He, while I was there, he had just been thrown in jail for beating up his wife. How do we cope in activist groups? How do we stay healthy? How do we foster ways of interacting, increasing diversity? How do we avoid the toxic behaviors of sexual and gender-based harassment and violence within activist groups? That many, particularly women, queer, trans activists, we are constantly resisting heteronormative, mostly cis male forms of gender-based violence, perpetration of gender-based violence within our groups. And this isn't just in far-flung places like South Africa. This was in Occupy Wall Street. This has been here in Berlin. So my question is, I've worked in 50 countries. I mean, I've seen it across Sub-Saharan Africa, North Africa, parts of the Middle East. I work with activists, rights defenders, humanitarian responders. It is a common story with a sad, long history. The burden of change is often expected to be on the shoulders of women, queer, and trans people. That hasn't gotten us far. It hasn't. So what I would like to invite is there someone in this audience, someone on the stage, who can give us all an example of a man activist in your groups, heteronormative cis male man, in your activist groups, who has taken a vocal stand against some form of sexual or gender-based violence within the group? And often these are issues that we cannot talk about externally because it can reflect poorly on the movement. It can literally make entire affinity groups or larger movements crumble from within. And that's happened over and over again, actually. It's one of the greatest threats to resistance actions and to movement building. It's just something that we can't often talk about publicly because we don't want it to, you know, to reflect badly on our comrades, on our, you know, the people we share values with otherwise. But it's one of the deepest forms of betrayal to experience violence by a fellow activist, someone who you really thought you were on the same team with, right? And I've just heard way too many of these stories. So, does someone in this room have an example? Not just where, like for example, a CCC member or someone kind of prominent in some of the Berlin groups has said, be excellent to each other, you know, or we don't accept any kind of harassment in this space. I don't mean that kind of top level. I mean in your everyday lives. Do you have an example?
We are on stage, so it's good that you call us. Okay, then I start. I have anecdotes. I mean, living in a squat with many people for many years, we had this sort of episodes, and our rule was very clear, out of the door as soon as possible. Actually, there was not even one person in charge of this. So it happened probably two or three times that it was like serious harassment. In other houses that I've been, there were like the person was immediately sent out and then was called back for an actual sort of court case, which can be nasty in a way, but also it needed to be cleared because not for everyone was clear what was happening. And these are, I think, are things that many people that lived in squat had to deal with. As you say, it's very common. The anecdote is a little provocation. Some people didn't took it really good. But in our living room for about 5 years, we had a sign, which was the advertisement of a sex worker company in Amsterdam, which is known to be very good towards sex workers. And we had that sign in the middle of the living room, like where all the living space was doing, you know, there was like this royer drap is called, the red drape, and has a very interesting history of 20 years of unionizing sex workers in Amsterdam. And we decided to put it there in the living room. And it was a very quick argument, you know, for people that looked for, I don't know, whatever sexual services they wanted to, just because they found someone appealing there. It was, didn't meant that it was for that. And we had, and some people also took it very badly, you know, but I think it was always a good starter for a subject of discussion, because also it was very direct. Like now we talk about the situation of sex workers, because, you know, you are possibly a consumer that is in dire need if you act like this.
Does anyone else from the audience maybe have an example now? Because
I have an example actually, and it's fitting. I think you were quoting me or Mitch about the being excellent to each other stuff, and which I appreciate. But when I came out as being gay, not all the time, but sometimes, depends on the day, I guess. I told Jaromil about that about 12 or 13 years ago. And this is in a time when if you were to tell an Italian hacker that you had sex with men, that was like pretty low on the acceptance scale. And Jaromil was totally fine with it, and in fact was encouraging and very positive, and encouraged me to continue with computer hacking and to do that kind of work where many people would have been exclusionary. So in other words, I was nobody and kind of weird and queer on a weird Croatian island, I think it was. We were in Viz. And he was just loving and accepting to me. So he was actually, weirdly enough, him being on this panel, he was that guy. When he could have, I mean, other people were definitely not as open to that, so. Well, I mean, there are lots of, I feel like there are lots of individual acts of kindness, and my experience with a lot of Italian men especially in that time, was not that. It's actually more machismo homophobia. And Jaromil himself was the exact opposite of that. So I just wanted to sort of say, strangely enough, with that question, that guy up there is an example of one of the very few computer hackers. And he, you know, back in the day, Jaromil, and he may be still, but definitely back in the day, he was a really badass black hat, really, really amazing computer hacker. And he could have been a homophobic asshole like the entire American hacker scene with very few exceptions. And he was the opposite of that. So I really experienced a lot of loving kindness from Jaromil directly.
Well, I also saw a few cases of positive examples when these issues are discussed openly and situations are improved. But of course, the majority of cases are negative and bad. I find that the best first step to approach these problems is to be open about it. Create a space in your campaign, in your movement, where people could feel comfortable talking about it. That is the first step. And let everyone who wants to say something speak openly. Start in small groups, and it may be helping. And related to that is, we have suicides in our movements. People who can't stand the pressure of surveillance and police harassment and whatever happens around them. High numbers. It's a taboo to talk about it. I've lost some friends during the years. And I feel badly because I didn't realize what was going on until it was too late. And once again, you must be open about it. You must talk about it. You must create spaces where people feel it's okay to talk about their own problems. Because your topic is extremely important. You know, wars are killing 300 people a day in the world. 100,000 a year. There are more people dying from domestic violence than in wars, and many, many more committing suicide than in wars. So these are serious issues that we need to lift up on the political agenda and be open. We must be open about it and create awareness about these are actual things going on. Not only because they could destroy our movements, but because people are suffering due to this.
And the movements are splitting sometimes. And the movements are splitting sometimes, even. There are huge issues created out of sexual behavior that are scaling up to the political level sometimes. It's quite terrible. I've seen that happen.
In terms of dealing with sexual harassment in social movements or racism and homophobia in social movements, my experience so far is that social movements don't take them seriously and act as if we're one big universal family, and we're not. And I think it's absolutely important to create spaces to organize. So when there are people of color, to organize as people of color inside the movement and create spaces of organizing and solidarity as counterpowers to the hegemonic powers in the organizations. They're there. Most of the people who are in positions of power, even on the activist left, want to keep those positions of power and are not looking to share it. And I don't think the benevolence is there, so I see it really from a relationship of power perspective. And I'm not sure I fully understood your intervention, but just in case I didn't, I'd like to say what I heard and then perhaps object a little bit to the analysis. If I understood right, you were saying that you put up the sex worker sign for advertisements because someone was being harassed, or as a way to prevent discussions around or prevent harassment. But sex and desire is very different from harassment, which is about power and domination. And those are two separate subjects. And so it's not because somebody had a desire for sex that they're actually harassing women or trans people. They're harassing them because they want to show power. So it's very, very different, and I wouldn't make a parallel between the two at all. Thank you.
The reason was not reasoning. In fact, one of us worked there. He worked as a cleaner in the it was not a company, it's a cooperative. And so he brought this home, and then we thought, okay, we put it up. We didn't know what we were doing. But it could be used as a sort of warning sign sometimes. It was, and probably as you say, it was not really like a deep good use of our political brain power, whatever, but it spawned also good conversations. And I think sex worker rights are a topic, were a topic also in our, I mean, in Amsterdam it is, so. It's separate, as you say. Thank you.
I'm back. I think for me, I would certainly say there are no easy solutions. And actually, I think any attempt at an easy solution is already wrong. But it's very important maybe to build up cultures where if there is a problem, whether it's sexist or racist, I mean, I have to say there are lots of like colored groups that don't have these same problems, like, so that it's always weird for me to hear people talking about people of color as if there aren't people of color here, because that already assumes that it's a white space and so on. So that's kind of, I'm sorry, I just think it's a bit weird. But one of the things that I think is you need spaces where people can raise issues, whatever those issues are, and there needs to be a two-way channel. And that if that's not happening, there's something wrong with the kind of political construction that you have. It doesn't matter what the problem is, and maybe these networks of trust are very important. Smaller groups need to work together, but you need a lot of information, and I think there's part of that just missing, but this ability to have a problem raised, addressed, understand what the problem is. Because somebody, let's say, like Julian Assange, who has been accused of being a rapist, and so then you have this kind of claim of sexism come up, and that's very highly politicized, where I would say that's, you know, clearly that's a case of an injustice. Whether or not he committed an act of violence against a woman is secondary to the fact that that's being used to politically harass him, and that's why he's sitting in the embassy in Ecuador. And I think that these are things that we have to be careful in how we use these terms, how they get applied to political groups, and how harmful they can be. Because there's another side to this story, and I would be absolutely on the side of being really reflective and making sure if we're talking about something and calling it sexist, is that sexism? Might be another problem, and maybe we're better off identifying that other problem.
I think we need to bring the issue of care front and center in social movements, and care needs to be factored in, and it needs to be very predominantly thought about and integrated in our strategies. I appreciated the safe space. I think safe spaces are important in every movement, and they need to be respected. People need to have the opportunity of creating safe spaces whenever they need. Speaking out is important. So if you see something happen, you need to speak out. And this is difficult, and we need to, you know, break this culture of silence, or this culture of difficulty to talk about certain subjects, and we need to do it in a collective setting. So I would definitely encourage everyone, particularly male, to speak out. And when they see racism, when they see sexism, it's really, really important. And then finally, the issue of privilege. I think we need to be aware of our own privileges, and we need to check our privileges on an everyday basis. And it's hard. It's really, really hard, but we need to do it. So I think that's, I'm going to stop here.
Thank you. Maybe I have a last question. We have to stop at 5 on time for all of you. That kind of relates to what we've been discussing in the last 10 minutes, because that's also on my list, and I think it's very important. One of the things that Theresa Züger also yesterday said is, and you mentioned it in your presentation, is this thing that people are too obedient, because it's easier to be quiet, to not to speak out. So one of the things is that I wanted to know from all of you maybe is, how can we involve more people in this kind of action, in this kind of resistance against what's wrong and undemocratic? what are the ways to kind of lower this threshold? And one thing that is hindering people is, I guess, also like that they feel not heard about. So maybe all of you a short statement.
I may be not the right person to answer this question. Since I have been doing this activist stuff and a lot of civil disobedience since I was quite young, when I became a father, I had some ideas about how to raise kids. And that's a difficult task in my life. My son ended up in law school. I'm not saying that every lawyer is a bad person, but it's not very much civil disobedience in the law school. So I maybe not know the answers, but I do know that the school system and most workplaces and universities are focusing on creating obedience. Sometimes when I'm in bad mood, I think the whole school system is there just to create obedience, not about grammar or geography or history. It is to create obedient citizens, and they are quite effective in doing that. So get your kids out of the school system and teach them how to act according to their own inner voice, and morality, whatever you want to call it. Let them get support when they are challenging you or any other in power from very early on. Support them when they test out the borders and the conflicts they have in home, in school systems, and in jobs. Everyone who dare to confront the people in power should be encouraged and supported. If you don't do that, you fall in line with the rest of us and the world will continue. I mean, I'm one of these elderly white males, okay? I was born in the world that was much better than the world I'm leaving very soon. I will be compost within a couple of years, or maybe 5 more years. I mean, they're going to be compost. So I'm sorry for my contribution, because I didn't do a very good job, since the world today is in much worse condition than it was in the 1950s. And if you don't do it better, that's the end of story. I really hope, and I do believe, that some of the young generation are so much more clever than what we were when I was 15, 20. So I see some hope in the tunnel. But we need to encourage all the young ones to act, and not only to listen and be obedient in the societies.
Should I? Well, I might just repeat more or less, but in another source, what I try to say. I took also some notes for today, things that I really wanted to get through. And I think that to be a multitude, and even better, to really develop a subjectivity, like something that we are proud of and that we fight for, and that is not just about ourselves, the single self, then we need really to see the media, our communication, not just as a one way, but more as a platform for people to communicate, to take care of each other. And on the other side, I think that privilege, what you bring up, it's a very important thing. It scales to the fact to also like to describe what we are fighting for. I mean, we are fighting for what we are fighting against. What we find often to fight against is like a huge privilege for power to be the judge and decision maker and everything around us, and then there is no space for criticism, there is no space for action. So I think that to answer the question that was posed yesterday, what we are fighting against is, in my case at least, and many comrades, is capitalism as the accumulation of power and money and rent and time and people's life. And so I think to go to a multitude today, we have also to go beyond the topic of privacy, which is mostly, again, addressing crisis situations and individuals, and look at these collective dimensions, as, for instance, rent, housing, and work, because these are conditions that are directly linked to capitalism and the necrotizing phase in which capitalism is today, and they can actually build a very, potentially very big constituency. They have a potential of subjectivity. The multitudes will actually relate to these problems that we all face, and we could face them in a united way from bottom up rather than top. So look around for the possibilities.
Okay, you have the last word.
And I guess very shortly, because I don't have the magic formula, but it's really, I would say what I'm trying to do in my own activism is really reaching out to other networks and really trying to create some linkages with groups that would maybe otherwise not connect to one another. And so so that's something that I do at a personal and activist level. It's also making visible what is invisible. And I think that's a very feminist practice. And whether it is the case study that I shared today with you about Africa, we rarely hear about technological hackerdom or technological innovation in Africa, but they are very inspiring practices that happen there. So it's a way to, you know, try to make visible, try to look for what is not there, what you don't necessarily see, but might exist and probably do exist. And keep the fight. It's hard, sometimes we get discouraged, but it's we need to keep going. And for that, we need a good network of people that we care about, but also care for us. And if we're, you know, having some hard time, it's good to take a step back. Taking a step back for a moment is fine. It's okay. We don't need to be constantly in the action. I think it's also about caring for oneself, and caring for oneself is also precious.
Yeah, thank you all. I mean, this is just, I guess, part of an ongoing discussion. I mean, it's not, we don't have the, we probably won't ever find the magic formula. It's just like one continuum, and I hope you found some inspiring moments, inspiring ideas here, and continue talking, and continue the conversation with each other. And before you run off, Tatiana has a final...
Yes. First of all, I wanted to thank the people on stage, and then I have to do a little announcement, so please don't run away, but I want everybody really to show a great appreciation for this wonderful panel. Thank you. And so actually, as usual, we have our little tradition to present the next topic of next time. And actually, I think that this connects really well with a lot of reflection done here, because we are actually shifting into the realm of sexuality. And so the next event will be called Porn Tube, and will be the October 31st. It's done in collaboration with the Porn Film Festival Berlin. And we are going to investigate the current development of the porn industry, especially analyzing also how actually pornography is changing with the use of the tube technology. And also we will bring together researchers, porn practitioners, porn entrepreneurs, critical thinkers that can analyze with us actually how pornography is changing, and also in which way we could imagine it as a practice that it could be potentially open to everybody and also be more sustainable for sex workers, for example. So I invite you to come October 31st, will be our second last event. Our last event will be December 12. And now I would like to conclude also to invite you to the next the second part of today, that will be at the Spectrum, the independent space in Berlin, close to Schönleinstrasse, in Burkenstrasse 12, in which there will be a crypto party organized by Crypto Party Berlin. Okay, Jorgen has to go because he has a flight. So, but I just conclude here. And so if you don't have the computer, don't worry, because you can also go with your mobile phone. And then they have a bar, so it will be a nice way to conclude these wonderful 2 days. So I would like to say thanks to all our Disruption Network Club team, to our fantastic video crew, Rofso Film, to Elle, our technician, and of course to Kim Foss, Gabriel, that also helped us this time because unfortunately Daniela was sick. So, but I want to thank of course also Daniela Silvestrin, that was not with us because she actually made also this happen, and Maria Silvano, that is our photographer, Jonas Franchi, our fantastic graphic and psychedelic illustrator and video maker. So thank you, and thanks for being with us.